where on my second launch I pulled in around 130 grand profit. Like my everything I was doing completely changed. The way, the strategy of everything I was doing completely changed, and I was at a point for so long where I was just so stuck that I wasn't happy with the results my students were getting, because you know, they're kind of buying a course and then never opening it, or never being, or just having too many questions and then just giving up with it. But the knowledge that I had within the first week is so helpful. And I think as a coach, you kind of just, you're so used to helping everyone else that it's hard for you to accept that you need help sometimes. But yeah, like invaluable advice and support.
Jazz, I know you've just been in like 5 or 6 different countries over the last couple months, back in Dubai now. And so you started as a social media manager, right? And that's how you grew your social media audience and do what you do now, helping others become social media managers. So there's always this moment where I think as entrepreneurs and founders, we have this internal realization, like, I am just not meant to have a normal job. So what was that actually for you? Because I think your story is interesting, and I see the impact you're making on so many people creating that freedom for themselves. So yeah, what happened to you?
So I think I was 19 at my last proper job. I'm 25 now. And I was a social media marketing manager in a digital marketing agency. And I got a job there as a social media assistant, and I thought, this is the best thing that's ever gonna happen to me in my life. This is my, you know, my career. I know you had the same kind of thing. I was like, yeah, this is how I'm gonna, you know, get a big job in a fancy office in London. I'm like, all this kind of stuff. I thought I'd really made it. And in 2 months of working there, I worked my way up to social media marketing manager. Within a year, I had a team of around 7 people, I think. I was the youngest person in the studio. I didn't have a degree, I had no qualifications. I just fucking loved social media, and I was just really, really passionate about it. I loved what I did. But I was on around 24 grand a year. I was working 10, 12 hour days, including on the weekends. I lived, breathed, and everything. That job was my life. The manager of the company was a bit of a bell end. Just didn't really care about anyone. We had to be in this office 10 hours a day for a job that I was doing from my laptop that I could have done anywhere in the world. And one day I remember I had a ton of work to do, and I finished work at around 8 or 9 p.m. and I lived half an hour away. So I got home around probably like 10 p.m.-ish. And the boss called me in the next morning, and he said, I thought you had a lot of work to do. You only got home at like 10 p.m. last night. He said, I thought you had a lot of stuff to do in front of everyone. And I handed my notice in about a week later. I had no plans, no fucking idea what I was doing. I was living with my parents at times, so obviously I wasn't going to die on the streets, but that was it. And since then, I've just been winging it, I suppose.
Well, until you found Impact School, right? No, but for real though, isn't it crazy how the amount that you are making in an entire year? I know you've had some, you know, big revenue days where even that's been something that as entrepreneurs, we can create our own reality and turn and compress the time into achieving more than we ever thought was realistic for ourselves when we first started out. And like, yeah, we had a similar story because I was actually working at an influencer marketing agency. The founder was not a bellend. He was actually a really great, nice guy, but I was getting paid like pennies because it was my internship while I was in uni before I dropped out. But your clients as well, I see the results that you're getting for them and the amount of revenue that they're making from their social media management businesses. And like, that type of revenue is the type of thing that they can achieve in like just a few months, right? When they really, really put in the work and get solid in what they're doing. And I know that's something that I always admired with you, because your product is so good that when you first told me how much you were selling it for, I was like, wait, what? Are you kidding me? Like, what's going on here? So let's talk about the journey of going from like low ticket to high ticket in your business, because I feel like this is something that we actually have a lot of people in our audience that have like agencies or freelance businesses who probably aren't right now at the stage where they could be a good client for Impact School. But I feel that if they hear your story about how you actually switched from, first of all, you mastered social media management and then you started helping others with it through a course. But like, how did you then go through the process of actually going into high ticket? And what were the mindset around that?
Yeah, okay. So when I first started selling the program, I think at one point I sold it for £250. But that was around 4 years ago, and I've been building on the program since then. I say this course has taken me 4 years to write because it's never finished. I'm always adding to it. It's like every, as trends of social media change as platforms come out, as new Facebook ad updates come out, I'm always adding to the course. I've had other experts jump in and help me with it as well, with like Facebook ad stuff. I've had seven-figure agency owners help me add some stuff in there as well. So it's like a lot of time, years one decade's worth of knowledge has gone into it. But with the program, it's in order to give people the support they needed, it just wasn't possible for me to, you know, spend the time and the energy into helping this many people. And the program, it was good, and some people like went on to make a lot of money from it, but some people would just buy it and that would be enough, you know, of a risk for them. That'd be enough of an investment, and they wouldn't, that would be it for them. That's their curiosity done. They wouldn't even open it. Mm-hmm. They do 2% of it and they go, okay, I'll pick it back up, and they put it off. And there's no one to hold them accountable. And I've got 2,000 students. They're in an old Facebook group for that program. I can't keep them all accountable. It's not physically possible. I couldn't invest in a huge support team to help them either, because I wouldn't be making any money off it. So it was just kind of program where some people do really well, the ones that were self-motivated, but the rest just kind of, they just didn't really do anything with it. And I didn't want to be selling a £700 or £300 program at times to a £700 program to people that were just going to, you know, not do anything with it, because then what am I doing then? What's the point? Yeah. So I knew I wanted to change into something where I could work one-on-one with people, and I could literally say to them like, okay, do this. I could answer all their questions, but I could dedicate the time into answering their questions, because I was being paid for my time as well. It wasn't just like I was taking, you know, one-off thing, and then I was just kind of helping them when I could. I wanted something where I could actually say, okay, you know, we're going to work together with this. You're going to follow a guide. We're going to work together for the next 12 weeks to get you to where you want to be. But that was fucking scary. It's hard to kind of know that there's things out there that you don't know, and it's hard to say, you know what, I need a complete change, and I have no idea. Everything needs to change, but I have no idea what it is. So that's when I reached out to Impact. So I think it was in November, and I was like, I'll reach out to Lauren in January, you know, January 1st, get started again. Then I reached one breaking point. I was like, no, I'm doing it now. Something needs to change. So that's when I introduced my new higher ticket program in January, which was like basically where we work together. We take on a limited amount of students, work together with them one-on-one, and build their agencies with them.
Yeah. And so that formula of repricing, repackaging, repositioning, everything is what internally inside of the company we are now calling a CEO scale system, right? Because you take your knowledge as a CEO, package it up into something which you already have in the course or in your head, right? Many people just have it in their head, and they kind of are currently doing it one-on-one for higher ticket, or maybe they're selling their time, or maybe they have a course, or maybe a few courses, membership. It positions it all into one product, which then you're able to replace yourself in. And as a CEO, you're able to take your knowledge and then train other people on how to train your clients within the product that they're buying. And you've done that really, really well, because I know in the first time around, you were willing to do some of the one-on-ones with the clients, right? As they were coming in to refine the product and dial it in. And that's something that I think is a mindset trait, which, man, you said there, like you've reached a breaking point. Like, I want to know what that breaking point was, but also you did something about it. And I see this in the best entrepreneurs, best founders, best, you know, wannabe entrepreneurs, if they're, you know, potentially your potential client, like they reach out for help and they actually do something about it. So what was going through your head at that breaking point, firstly? And secondly, talk me through the process of that first time around of working with that group of clients and like how it was for you personally as a CEO.
I think it was a few months of kind of just plateauing, things aren't getting plateauing, that's the right word. Things were fine, you know, they were okay, but you know, I still had some people that I employed. I think it was like one or two. I had a girl that helped out in the Facebook group, and then a couple of other things, but like there just wasn't really, it was just okay, it wasn't really going anywhere. You know, I had people DMing, but I'd increased the price of the course because I knew it was worth more. Even when I posted on my stories like I'm increasing the price, I had students messaging me and be like, bro, you should have done this months ago. Like people that have bought the course, and they were like, you need to charge way more. You need to be charging double. Like people that have bought the course telling me to do this. But the people I was speaking to, it was just too expensive for them. And I want to help them, and I want to provide them something, but also I can't sell, you know, my 10 years worth of knowledge at a completely discounted rate. And also, like if it's too cheap, people don't take it seriously. So I was just like, it's just what I'm doing, I pushed so far into what I can do now, and I've kind of increased my price as much as it possibly can to the point where it's causing a problem, that something just, it's not even something needs to change, it was just everything, the whole thing needs to change. So it was a couple months after just kind of being all right, being a bit stagnant, to then I was just like, no, something needs to change. I think investing that amount of money as well, it forces you to take it seriously as well. Even if you like, even if you don't believe in yourself and you haven't got motivation, you're like, okay, I've just spent that money. Like I need to do this now.
Yeah. Yeah. So I hear you, and I've had similar experiences myself when I've invested large chunks of money. It's like, okay, now let's friggin' go. It's like your students as well, when they join with you, it's like, okay, now they've paid the high ticket price point. When people pay, they pay attention. Right.
Yeah. And so you did this, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So you did the first launch of your CEO scale system. You do really great TikToks, by the way. So people can check out your TikTok. The username, is it the same as Instagram? What's the at handle?
JXX, I think.
Okay. JXS.
JXF. Okay. JXX. Sorry.
JXX. Double X.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Okay. Got it. Okay. Yeah. I love the username. You got really, I love those three letter username. That's really cool. How to support someone that like does social media for a living, you know?
Yeah. Me and Mark Zuckerberg are like this.
I love it. Yeah. Cause he sees you crushing it on TikTok. Yeah, I'm sure. So, let's talk about this. So that was the first time around. So it didn't go quite as you wanted to, but you were able to systematize now. So that for the future, things will be more smooth. So second time around, rather than kind of rolling it out evergreen, you did another launch, right? Because things were not 100% smooth the first time. So we do another launch to make sure that it's going to be smooth this time. What happened there? What was different? And how did your team and clients find it?
So we're currently on the second launch. We're 1 month into the second launch. Mm-hmm. I've also extended the program as well because I thought that students would be able to achieve a lot in 8 weeks, but it was just nowhere near long enough for everything that was being built. But like I said,
yeah.
I had to make that mistake in order to realize that it wasn't long enough.
So
extended the program. But yeah, things are a lot smoother now. I definitely had a lot of anxiety because I was just, every time I picked up my Slack, opened my Slack app, I was like, oh, everyone's annoyed at me. Like things are always going wrong. But now like each success manager deals with their own students a lot more. So now when I open my phone, you know, it's messages, people asking for advice or people sending me, you know, I've got my branding back and I love it. But each success manager deals with a lot more of their own students instead of me just kind of managing a lot of work for like 70 different people, the success manager dealing with them. But it had to go wrong in order to go right. I think that has to happen with a lot of people. A lot of people don't realize like you are going to fuck shit up. Things are going to go wrong. You're not a brain surgeon. Like no one's going to die in the process. It's fine. But sometimes you do have to get stuck in and things have to go wrong, but it's all part of the process.
100%. Yeah, because now you have this product which is able to be scaled and you can sell it on demand whenever you need to. I know your problem was like nothing to do with leads. You had more leads coming in than you could possibly even handle. Like, I actually wanted to ask you about that, the disqualification now of the leads, because before there was always so many DMs all the time. So how are you handling the disqualification now to make sure that you're protecting your time and energy?
So I say straight up, like before, what I used to do before is I would be kind of secretive about the price of the program because I feel like sometimes if people see the price, they get put off before they see the value of like, you know how it is. I don't want people to come, you know, waste my time or waste their time if they, like, I don't want to sell them on a program that they're going to go, yeah, this is amazing if they can't afford that. I also have I have another low ticket offer now, which is like £300. So for people that really can't afford that high ticket offer, they can still get the information they need. A lot of people, when I stopped selling my old low ticket course and I only went selling high ticket, I had a lot of people angry at me for not selling something that they could afford, which I get. Yeah. But then on the other hand, I was like, I had people that were like messaging all my followers trying to buy the course off them because I wasn't selling it anymore. Because I like closed doors to it. And I had people that like, I was going to have my tagline on my landing page be like, people do dumb illegal shit to get access to this course. Like they were doing like, well, messaging people asking to buy it off them. And I was like, you cannot do that.
Crazy.
But yeah, no, I sell something low. It's a smaller product now that helps people that can't afford the bigger price still. And I can go through that if they can't afford the high ticket.
Yeah, because like it's just a simple link sent in the DMs, right? Like, you know, you find out, okay, how much have you set aside to invest into starting your, you know, XYZ social media agency for you? And then or social media management business. And then if it's, okay, £500 or $500, okay, no problem. This is going to be the best fit for you. And then yeah. It's just an easy disqualification because I feel like one of the biggest things that a lot of people do is they go through, they, you know, have a whole sales conversation and they then find out at the end that the objection is the person legit just doesn't have the money.
Yeah.
Whereas instead, if you find out in the beginning, then you're able to just disqualify quickly. If you have big lead flow, this is a very important thing that I think a lot of people miss. So, all right. So then like, You're really killing it on TikTok. What's your secret to TikTok?
Do you know what? It's so funny, is that I started TikTok about 2, 3 years ago because I had always been the face behind brand, like the not the face, but the brains behind different brands. And I had some like clients where I could do really, really funny shit. I could post funny shit. I could reply to people in the comments and be quite funny. But no one knew it was me. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to build my own platform. You know, I've been stuck behind for 10 years now. I've been stuck behind other people's brands, not getting the credit for who I am and my personality. So I was like, okay, I'm just going to start posting on TikTok. And I've just had some videos blow up for the dumbest things. I've had videos featured in the Daily Mail because I've been talking about how I went to a hair braider in Thailand and they messed my hair up, like the dumbest things. And I just find I tried for a while to be very, you know, to be talk about work and be professional. And I used to do days in the lives and I would take hours for creating them and I'd write a script of things that I was going to say so I could say it properly. But I find the more unhinged, chaotic, realistic, and weird that I am, the more people love it because people come onto TikTok to see real stuff. I don't want to see your day in the life video where you're doing a yacht in the morning and then you're seeing Nusret in the afternoon, and then you've got a beach club, and then you've got buying a Lambo, and then you've got dinner at Salt Bay. I don't care. No one cares. People want to see realistic, weird stuff, and I think that's why people enjoy watching my videos.
Yeah, no, I love it. It's cool and it's perfect for your ideal client as well, right? Because like they love social media, they get it, they're scrolling on it anyways. And so I think like for you it's perfect. And I think I've personally seen a similar thing. I think people like are pretty sick of like the same old samey type of stuff that's always there all the time. And so I find like for me it's maybe similar to you on TikTok, but for me on Instagram stories, when I do that, that's when it goes crazy. But it's also like knowing your client, right? Because if, you know, let's say there's someone watching this and their clients are like bankers, right? Or like really corporate professionals.
No,
Oh,
I
that's
like
funny. Okay.
from the clients I've worked with, they've always had like quite a naughty tone of voice. Like I've had clients that there was one like a burger restaurant where they sold mini burgers and you got a discount if you had like three of the same. And I remember posting as a caption once, it was like, this is the only threesome that you don't have to delete your browser history after for. So something like that. But that's why I love like working with those types of clients because I can like be myself, that my brand voice aligns with their brand voice.
That's actually a really powerful lesson, like for, you know, with what your clients do, because that's true. Like, I never really thought about it from that perspective as a social media manager. And that helps anyone who's watching this that's potentially trying to hire a copywriter for their business, like vetting to make sure that they have the same kind of banter as you.
Oh yeah, 1,000%. Yeah, obviously everyone's tone of voice is different, but yeah, they need to like you need to speak the same. You need to understand like who your clients are.
No, 100%. Okay. So, Jazz, like on a day-to-day basis now, what are you spending most of your time doing now that you have the high ticket offer, the low ticket that you use to disqualify prospects? How's your time spent?
Do you know what? I would love to say that I wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning, have a cold shower, and then reply to messages and go to the gym. I honestly there is no typical day for me. I have this is my to do like my to do list is on a bit of paper like this. Like I'm the messiest, most unorganized person. Sometimes I'll wake up in the morning and I'll reply to, you know, messages on my phone, then I'll spend 4 hours in the gym talking to random people, and half the time I'll be replying to DMs on my phone, and then I'll come back and spend, you know, there's no typical day, but I'll you know, spend a few hours in the morning like do in the gym or replying to messages or whatever, and then it'll get back, be checking in with the team. So a lot of the stuff that social media marketing stuff I do now is outsourced. One of my success managers, she deals with the most of the stuff from my agency. So generally like checking in with the team, replying to students on Slack messages, and then once a week I have a call, group coaching call with all of the students together. Even though I've removed myself a lot from the program now, I still like to be curious and go through and see what everyone's branding looks like and what everyone's websites look like and making sure that everyone's happy. But yeah, I'd say 90% of my time is probably on Slack throughout the
Okay. Wait, so I like okay, so what do you need to now replace yourself in next? Like, where do you want to next replace yourself? Because I'm gonna make sure that we make it happen, so
I don't know if I could. I think because so everyone gets a coaching call with me, group coaching call with me. Obviously, I can't, unless, I don't know, it depends on how good Chat GPT gets, but I don't think I can replace myself with that quite yet. And obviously they get the one-on-one support with me. If they've spoken to me in the DMs, they're buying from me, they wanna get, you know, access to me to speak to me. But I think other than some little admin bits, you know, maybe checking things over in terms of like payment plans or customer service, I think other than that, I think I've outsourced as much as I can outsource, I think. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know.
Yeah, I feel like the next thing that we need to work on is replacing you when it comes to like a true head of client success, like a real head of client success where you maintain control of the product and the quality of the product. Because I always like to split out like the product, which is CEO scale system, right? Like the program that you have. I like to split that out with client experience, right? So then the client experience can be headed up by somebody else. You
Okay,
maintaining
yeah.
control of products is important, but then head of client experience, who all of the managers, you mentioned like you have different little pods who have different coaches, right? Like all of those coaches would then report to the head of client success, and then the head of client success would have like criteria, that they can kind of bend things, like if ever a refund needs to be approved, if it's up to a certain amount, they already have approval, so it doesn't have to come to you. Just things like that that will
Yeah.
save your energy so that less problems have to come to you and you can stay more in that, like, because I can see from what you said already, you don't like having stuff on your calendar. You like to kind of just do whatever you want to do when
Yeah.
you want to do it. I am the same. I am so the same as you. And so that then protects your energy, right? So that then the problems are going to that person, but they have to be someone that you really, really trust. But we can talk about this, off air. I kind of forgot
Yeah.
we were recording
Yeah,
that
that makes a lot of sense. No, I agree with that. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. So that's what we'll work on next. And then when it comes to like things that still kind of stress you out in your business that people should be aware of when they're starting to get their business to like when they get a high ticket offer to the level of clients that you have right now, what are some things that are kind of still stressing you out a bit?
Do you know what? I was thinking about this the other day, and if I get an inkling that someone isn't happy with the program or something's gone wrong, or especially if it's something that I could have stopped myself or something that I've missed out on, it stresses me out to another level. It gives me anxiety. It really, really stresses me out. If I think someone that isn't happy with something or something's gone wrong, it really, really stresses me out. But in a way that's almost helped me because I just care so much about every single person's success. Like it, obviously, it's not good to be anxious. But it just means that I'm so motivated. If something happens at, midnight and it needs fixing right there and then, as a business owner, like you never fully clock off. So I guess it's one of those, isn't it? Like you have to have that there. You kind of have to care about your students' results as much as you do, because like you said on your stories as well, like if you're only paid based on results, how much would you truly get paid? And that's so important.
And I think as well, like one thing that actually a mentor of mine told me once is like, that's your winning strategy until now, is like always being on top of everything, like immediately replying to everything. And that's got the product to be really quality. And so then it's like, what's the winning strategy going to be moving forward? Because for you personally, as a business owner, that anxiety is helpful, but then there becomes a level in which it kind of can burn you out, and then you become a bad leader for the team, right? That's something that I learned the hard way, is that because I was always on, my team felt like they had to be as well, and that then burned them out, made them leave, right? And it was just causing this churn. So it's like, how could you add some protective barriers so that your mind is focusing on being like proactive in that thinking zone rather than like reactive and stressed? That's something that I want to work on with you to actually make sure that we make that happen, because that for me would be like a real mark of like winning success in the next stage of your growth with us at Impact School. So we'll talk about that off the air.
Yeah, I would
But yeah.
enjoy talking about that, I think.
Cool. Yeah, no, we definitely will. Amazing. Cool. So with that said, for anyone that's considering joining Impact School, I would like to know one thing that you feel like we need to improve inside of the business. Firstly, before we go into what you would in general say for anyone that would join. So how can we improve at Impact School? What would you say?
I
Just
don't know.
be real, 'cause like be real, be real.
I don't know. I think I definitely haven't made the most out of the stuff. I've got the alerts on my calendar about all the Zoom calls, and I've never joined a single one. So I definitely think I haven't made the most out of the program. I think Michaela's my like support manager now, and she messages me like checking in all the time, like what are your goals for this week? And I'm too busy to think about what my goals are this week. So I don't know. I think. Oh, I'd say I haven't made the most of the program. Like I haven't, like obviously I've got what I needed to out of it, but I haven't like been joining in. So I don't know. I say the only criticism I have is that I haven't joined in enough. I don't know what else I could say.
Oh my goodness. You're so funny. I'm putting this on the spot, like when I'm doing these calls sometimes, because it's like literally the most helpful feedback for me ever. Because for example, like one of our other clients, Harriet, she said that she would like a direct one-on-one support when it comes to marketing. That's her weakness, is like actually lead gen. So we made that happen right after that call. So I guess with you, it's like, how can we be on your ass so much to make sure that we're able to like more proactively help and support you? So that's the feedback I needed to hear, because Michaela's messaging you and she's not able to tie you down, I need to make sure that our leadership is stronger than your avoidance. That's my
move in. Yeah.
Yeah, she does. Yeah, she does. Okay, cool. And then second thing, for anyone that's like considering joining, or who's maybe wondering, you know, what is Impact School all about, what would you say to them is the primary outcome that you feel satisfied with achieving since you started with us?
Yeah, no, 1000% do it. It was such a big investment for me, of course, like it's a lot of money to invest, but I was just like, as long as I can make this money back from one launch, then it's worth it, of course, even if it's only 1% more, then it's worth it. But the knowledge that I had within the first week with the success manager that I had that I was talking to was just, it's going to help me make that money back again and again and again. So 1000%, it's just having that knowledge there, being held accountable as well, and just having someone, you know, when you're like, oh, I'm not sure if this is going to work, and I've because I've always been the one, like as a coach, I've always been the one that helps people, and they've always come to me and they've been like, oh, okay, got that question answered, thank God. I never had that. Mm. Just having someone there that I knew could answer my questions, and just even when I wasn't sure whether to do this or this, they could say, no, okay, do this. Just having like someone there to kind of put those fears into, and then just take the imposter syndrome away and give me the right answer back. It's just, it's so helpful. And I think as a coach, you're so used to helping everyone else that it's hard for you to accept that you need help sometimes. But yeah, like invaluable advice and support.
Yeah, and I remember you mentioned that actually, that it was hard to go out and actually ask for the help, because you are always the one that people turn to, right? Mm. So yeah, like how do you feel about it now? Are you still feeling uncomfortable about the fact that you went and got help?
Oh, no way. No, not at all. I think I heard something the other day. It was like, people that aren't intelligent think they know everything, whereas people that are intelligent know they don't know everything. They know there's more to learn. They know they're not an expert in everything. So 1000%, I think, like, for a long time, I've always said to like my students, like, I'm like, you can go out and learn, like, how to do this by yourself. You don't have to invest in my help. But I've got 10 years experience. I've made all the mistakes, so you can cut out. You can use my 10 years of knowledge to cut out all those mistakes. And there are people out there that have got way more successful businesses than me that I can learn from, and that can just save me 10 hours and 10 grand worth of money wasted with one answer to a question. So yeah, no, 1000%, you should. I've been telling people they should invest in me, so why the fuck wouldn't I invest in someone else who's got more experience than me?
Thanks. Yeah, it's like, I think it was Aristotle, was the more you know, the more you realize you don't know.
Yeah, no, 1000%, yeah.
I love it. Jazz, thank you so much. This has been really fun. So grateful to serve you. Super proud of your results and your success. And yeah, your just willingness to get stuck in, because you care so much about client results. Exactly how we like to serve people. And anyone watching this right now, if you're interested in becoming a client of Impact Schools, there's going to be a link in the description box below that you can just click on, and it will take you over through to an application to sign, to, I don't know, what's the word, to fill out, to see if we can actually serve you. So thank you so much for watching. Jazz, this was fun. And yeah, have a great night in Dubai.
Thank you.